About Dogs on BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.
Good evening and welcome to the Berks County Kennel Club's program, All About Dogs. Hi, I'm Pat Mock, your host, and I hope we've all recovered from our Halloween surprise. I know I just got my electric back about 5 o'clock this evening. I still don't have any phone service. But I have to thank Eileen at Hairs to You. She made me look beautiful this evening because I really looked a wreck all these days. But before we begin on this evening's program, I did want to present these checks to BCTV. The one is from the Berks County Kennel Club. The other is from the Berks County Dog Training Club. And we support BCTV. We hope you do too. Now, our guests this evening, I said we were going to have two breeds that were not common and we've never had on the program before, and we got them, okay? We have the Bull Terrier, which is the white one over on this side of me. Well, and then we have, on the other side of me, we have two Irish red and white setters. Not two red and white Irish setters. I was told they are Irish red and white setters. So I think, first of all, we will talk to Scott with his Bull Terrier, since it's a peculiar-looking dog. We've had, 2 months ago, I had the Bedlingtons on, and she was talking about the head that doesn't have the stop, which is, you know, the dent at the top of the, you know, right here between the eyes. Well, the Bull Terrier doesn't have that. The head goes sort of like concave? No, convex. Convex, that's what it is. It sticks out. It's got like a bump on it. Can we show, I don't know her name.
It's Nina.
Nina, okay. Can we show Nina's head? Maybe you can turn Nina around a little bit. There you go. So you can see it's a strange looking head. If any of you remember the Budweiser commercial, the Spuds dog, I think Spuds had a spot around his eye though. But this is the Spuds dog. And this is also the dog that won Best in Show at Westminster, about maybe 5 years ago. This, what the dog there was Rufus. And I know Rufus has been at a number of dog shows in the area over the years because people always wanted their picture taken with Rufus. Rufus was really a sweetheart. And, you know, it was the same with the Beagle. Those are breeds that don't usually win Best in Show. But suppose you tell us a little bit about the Bull Terrier. Like, why was it bred? What is it supposed to do?
Well, Bull Terrier.
If we can get this little Irish red and white setter to shut her mouth.
Bull Terriers are the cross of between the Bulldog and the White English Terrier back in the 1880s. And they were originally bred to be able to, unfortunately, go back to the bull and baiting sports that were part of England back in that time. It's where they either baited a bull or a bear or drew a badger out of a hole.
Mm-hmm.
And bull terriers were supposed to be strong and powerful and have very strong jaws to be able to go down to ground and be able to pull the fox or the badger out of the hole.
Okay.
And so the breed originally started there, and a gentleman by the name of James Hinks, back at around 1890 or so, really thought that this was more of a gentleman's breed, and started to just change the breed into such a, what we see today, with the sweet, amenable disposition and temperament, and full of fire, ready to do anything, but very loyal to their master, and just a great dog.
Right, very good. Well, yeah, you wouldn't think that you say, you know, Bull Terrier, and it's like, oh my goodness, this dog was used for bull baiting, and it's going to be an aggressive breed. And they are not. I mean, even like the English Bulldogs, they're very, very friendly. It's like, hi, I love you. Yeah. Not very good watchdogs, though, right?
Bull Terriers, they're probably not what I would consider a good watchdog. The burglar goes to the freezer and finds a good steak and throws it to the Bull Terrier.
Right.
And they'll just tell you to close the door on the way out so they can finish their meal.
Well, they probably would. She would probably mob the person on the way in saying, hi, pet me. You know, she's a little character. Knock you over. How much does she weigh?
She's probably about 50 pounds.
Really?
And the bull terriers are supposed to be very dense and stocky. They're kind of like horizontal fire plugs.
Right, and that's exactly when she bounces on you, when she jumps on you, she does almost knock you over. She really is a husky kind of little dog. Mm-hmm. Where did the head come from then? Why that head style?
Well, bull terriers are just like in a lot of other breeds, is that based on the standard, mm-hmm. Breeders are looking for to being able to carry their lines and carry the positive traits from the breed. Mm-hmm. And as the breed has progressed, breeders have looked to be able to get that pronounced look with the turn of the head, the very varminty expression of the eyes.
And, right. Well, we're seeing is her tail.
Yeah. From a front view, she'll probably give you the look of a bird to where she's kind of now interested so much in the food.
Yeah.
But they're very alert and they're looking kind of almost through you when they're staring at you. They're looking at the next person or whoever's got the food behind
yes,
you.
Yes, that's exactly right. And, yeah. Very food motivated.
Yeah.
But not very good obedience dogs.
I wouldn't agree with that.
Really? Okay.
They can be. They uh-huh. need to be trained early,
mm-hmm.
and they need a lot of firm discipline.
Okay.
An awful lot of patience, and because this is a breed that kind of lives by Murphy's Law and uh-huh. does her own thing, and
right.
sometimes they may decide to take a break and go to the party next door.
Okay.
And,
okay.
And then they come back, and it's like, well, everything's
weren't any fun.
Nothing's any fun. They want to be right involved in the party.
Yes.
And do everything that's going to make them happy.
Right, right. Yeah, they sort of have their own agenda. And if it's not fun for them, they're not going to do it. Which is,
yeah.
which I think is like a lot of the terriers. If it's not enjoyable, why bother to do this? Let's sure. go to the party.
Mm-hmm.
What are the colors that they come in? Now, she's considered a white.
Yeah,
there's two classes, right? White and colored.
There are varieties.
Okay.
And it's white and colored, and there's also miniatures.
Oh,
and
okay.
so the
okay.
miniatures, both the white and colored, are shown together.
Okay.
And but for bull terriers, the varieties are white, obviously, and they can have any color on their body as long as it's the front of the shoulders. So
uh-huh.
usually, a lot of times, you'll see bull terriers with a lot of different markings on them around their ears and their
okay.
eyes.
Okay.
But there really shouldn't be any markings on their body.
Okay.
Every once in a while, you'll see some very good bull terriers that will have markings on their body,
uh-huh.
and it should be, when you're judging them, it should be really looked at as a fault.
Okay.
And but judged based on the fault, and also of how bad of a fault it is.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Obviously, if you have a really good bull terrier and it's mismarked, I think that the judge may forgo it a little more if they don't have something in the ring that's equally as good.
With the couldn't you show that then as a colored one, or must you have on a colored bull terrier? Must you have the entire dog colored with just white, like
yeah.
an all brown? They come in all varieties, a black and brown.
Yeah,
they come in lemon.
They come in black brindle.
Okay.
And usually black brindle is having brindle markings with black and white.
Uh-huh.
They'll have tricolor.
Okay.
And they'll have brindle.
Okay.
And any of the colors. The color needs to be the predominant color.
Right.
So obviously,
okay.
you want to,
right,
if
right.
you're 50-50, then you really can't discern whether it's a
yes.
white or a colored.
Yes.
So obviously, it's probably doesn't fit the bill.
Mm-hmm.
And,
right, right. If it's neither one, then it's,
and there
it's
are
a
all,
nice pet.
Yeah. Nina here has red markings. Her father is red.
Okay.
And her mother was white. And with red ears also.
Uh-huh.
And she actually looks an awful lot like her mother.
Yeah.
And
so then you can breed the two of them together, the white with the colored?
You do that all the time.
Oh, okay.
And another
okay.
reason why you do that is because in this breed, breeding white to white together, a lot of times you will create traits within the breed that
mm-hmm.
you may not want, especially from a health standpoint.
Okay.
Hearing.
Mm-hmm.
White-to-white breedings have known to be able to have a higher severity of deafness in the breed.
Okay.
And so...
Right, right. Well, what? Since we're on that subject, other than the deafness, which, Dalmatians are not the only breed that have deafness. There are, so many people say, oh, well, it's a Dalmatian, so, you got to check the hearing. But they don't think about the white English Bulldog. which mm-hmm. can be deaf. They don't think about the Bull Terrier, which, you know, white Bull Terrier, which can be deaf. You know, mm-hmm. people don't think about other breeds because it's been so, you know, pushed that the Dalmatians are the only ones that have deafness, which is mm-hmm. not true. And I think the deafness in the Dalmatians probably came from the Bull Terrier that was, or the Bulldog that was introduced way, way back. Mm-hmm. I'm not quite sure, but I think that's what they're saying. But other than the deafness, what other problems do you have with these guys?
Bull Terriers, they have heart issues,
okay.
and they also have kidney issues.
Wow.
And,
okay.
They're really, the two biggies are the heart and the kidney, obviously, because of being life-threatening.
Mm-hmm.
And obviously, to your viewers, a lot of people that may be, you know, thinking about getting a Bull Terrier, that they should, you know, go to a breeder,
mm-hmm.
somebody that's done this, like to go see pet owners or puppy owners, prospective buyers, be able to go to people that will go to breeders that show,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
because obviously they have a goal in
That's
mind
exactly
of being able
right.
to try to progress the breed.
Right.
They have an understanding of the strength and weaknesses of their line, hopefully.
Mm-hmm.
They also have an idea of the strength and weaknesses of the mm-hmm. breed.
Right.
And with that, it gives them an opportunity to be able to try to improve their lines mm-hmm. and also improve the breed.
Right. Plus, it's not a real popular breed.
No, it's not.
You know, it's difficult. I mean, we have the Bull Terrier Club of Philadelphia, which, you know, we're lucky enough to have. But it's not a breed that you see, you know, walking down the street. You know, it's just not very common. I'm not quite sure why. Of course, you guys probably love that it's not very popular. But
it's not a popular breed because I think that, you know, a lot of people, you know, they buy a dog and they want it to be part of the family.
Mm-hmm.
They don't want it to run their lives.
Yes.
And Bull Terriers, unfortunately, without the right amount of training and proper instruction and correction, you know, they can be a handful.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they can actually be very disruptive in a person's life. They can become more of a problem than what they have maybe with other things in their lives.
Right.
And it's just,
right.
Unfortunately, this isn't a breed that really does well being put into rescue situations.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And we have a very active rescue organization within the National Club. They mm-hmm. do a wonderful job.
Good.
And
yeah, I think a lot of, I would probably say most breed clubs now have good rescue groups mm-hmm. that rescue that specific, their specific breed. How are these dogs with kids?
Well, I always like to say that, you know, you should never leave any dog loose with a small child,
right?
Regardless. But Bull Terriers are like a three-year-old child in a dog suit, probably until they're about six or seven.
Okay.
And
okay.
They have a real zest for life and a mm-hmm. real zest to being kind of the center of attention.
So we'd need a real active family.
You don't need necessarily an active family.
Oh.
You need a family that understands the breed.
Okay.
Has a fence yard,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Has the time of day to be able to give it what it's looking for.
Right.
And most of it is, you know, a lot of couch time.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they really, they're a very personal breed, and they really strive to be able to get human companionship.
Well, I don't want to interrupt you here, but we do have to take a break, so stay tuned. We'll be right back.
You're watching All About Dogs on bctv.org. Be informed, be involved, be a member. For membership information, go to www.bctv.org/support/membership. For more information and other stories about animals and pets, go to www.bctv.org. All About Dogs is underwritten by the Berks County Kennel Club and by Berks Dog Training Club. For more information on how you and your business can become program underwriters, go to www.bctv.org.
We're back. So because they're short-coated, they really don't need very much grooming. I mean, like a wash-and-wear dog kind of thing.
Oh, very much wash-and-wear.
Okay.
It's just our dogs kind of get bathed, you know, once every few months.
And put them out in the rain, huh?
Yeah, it's nice because they go out and they wrestle out in the Montgomery red clay, and
mm-hmm.
they come in somewhat a little bit dirty, dry, and you brush them off, and they're ready to go.
Yeah, yeah, that's the nice thing about, you know, a short-coated dog. So how about we talk to Wendy And Wendy has the Irish red and white setters. So, I talked to Wendy on Saturday, and she's on her cell phone, and she says to me, well, give me the information, email me the information, because I'm at a hunt test. In that snowfall, they're at a hunt test.
Yes,
but the dogs passed. So
yes, they both got their first junior hunter pass this weekend.
Which is wonderful.
Yes.
Which is wonderful. Yes. So suppose you tell us a little bit about this breed. Like, you know, what is it?
Right. And Irish red and white setters are basically the original Irish setter. When the dog shows started and they started showing dogs, the reds became popular in the ring, and they kind of, the two varieties basically split apart into separate breeds.
Okay.
And these guys pretty much didn't stay in the show ring. They just stayed back on the farms and being hunted and used for birds. And they pretty much stayed the same way they were back in the 1800s. So if you find some old pictures of hunting dogs out there, pheasant dogs and stuff, and, you know, looking from England and Ireland over there, you'll see these dogs in
the
pictures.
Right. That's right. You will. Mm-hmm. That's exactly right. I didn't give that a thought until right now. And you know, thinking back to some of the old art, you do see them with the English setters and
you'll see the
Gordons. You don't really see the red setter as much as you do the red and white.
Exactly.
Now, these guys were just recognized, what, in about?
January 1st, 2009, they got the full AKC registration and were able to start showing. And before that, they were able to do hunt tests and performance events, but that's when we were able to go into the show ring.
Right.
So this is our third year in the show ring this year.
So this breed is not, at this point, real popular, or is this more popular with people who do hunt tests?
They're still very rare.
There's
probably less than 1,000 of them in the U.S. Very few litters born every year. So, if someone's looking to get one, they should really research and make sure it's the right breed for them. They're very, as you can see, very energetic.
Yes, they are very energetic. and I think she's snapping at
first. There's a bug.
There's a bug. I didn't see a bug, but she
ate it. There's a bug. But she, yes. we're excited about the bug, too. Yes. They need a lot of exercise, as any sporting breed.
Right, you know, right. So that's exactly right.
As any sporting breed, they need a lot of exercise, but they also, he was saying about couch time, they have to have their couch time. These dogs are not a good kennel dog.
Okay.
They need to be in the house.
Mm-hmm.
They're not the type of dog that you can leave in a run out in the yard and expect them to be happy.
Yeah, well, no dog would be happy
there's a lot of hunting dogs that you might see that way, that are raised that way. And these guys, they need to be with their people in the house, on the couch, in your lap.
Uh-huh.
And then they will happily go out and go bird hunting with you also.
And
they do obedience, they do agility. Some people do tracking with them. So they're pretty much in all of the performance events now.
And they, too, are very personable. They're
very friendly, yes.
Wild.
Yes, they are. They're very, like I said, they are not for everybody. I don't recommend them for people with small children.
Okay.
Simply because of the fact that they'll knock them over.
Mm-hmm.
They will knock them over.
Yes, somebody's coming to visit. So.
Yes. And this is normal. This is normal red and white behavior.
Okay. Does it matter how much spotting they have?
No, it's not. The standard just says that they have to be islands of red on a sea of white. So you have to make sure that, and it should be a deep, rich color and maximum bloom. They want the white to be nice and pearly, and the red to be nice and red.
Okay. And it doesn't matter that they have.
They're allowed to have freckles on their face and their legs.
Okay.
But they shouldn't have them on their body like an English setter does.
Okay. Would these guys make good apartment dogs?
You'd have to be pretty devoted to exercise, and they need to have off leash exercise.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they need to be able to run.
And I would guess that,
and play.
You know, the they're not very good watchdogs either.
Well, they will bark.
Uh-huh.
But they're not gonna, you know, they're not gonna scare anybody away. But they will alert you that someone's there.
Oh, okay.
But
okay.
As far as that goes, you know,
okay.
It's probably the same thing.
Because she's barking at her, it's not that they're going to. They're not noisy, is what I'm trying to.
Well, only with the they don't run around barking unless they see something or something new is going on.
Okay. When they're taking my desk away.
Yeah. Normally, when they run around and play, they're pretty quiet.
How old are they?
The puppy is 7 months, and this one is just two.
Okay.
So she's. basically a puppy, too.
The one that was climbing on the table is a two-year-old.
Yes.
She's also the one that was trying to chew the microphone cord, too, right?
Yes. Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So that's what you have in a two-year-old. The seven-month-old, you can understand,
is
chewing the leash.
She's eating the leash, yes.
This is what you have at age two. So you got to be aware of that as well.
Yes.
You know, they are high-energy dogs.
They are high-energy dogs. The best home for one of these dogs is someone who's had another setter breed before.
Okay.
Maybe, you know, it doesn't have to be a red and white, but if they've had another setter, they're used to the exuberance of the breeds, or even any other sporting breed.
You know. Are they more intelligent than the Irish?
I hope nobody with Irish setters is watching. They're not. They're more.
Sorry.
I guess I would say they're more serious.
Okay.
They're more serious. They take things a little more, because I guess the Irish setters are what they like. They tend to say that they're very clown-like.
Oh yeah.
And bouncy, and these guys can be more serious, especially when they get out to start doing their field work.
Okay. Okay.
They're very.
The Irish setters, at least the show setters, just seem to me to be a little bit wifty. Hi, hello there. Here I am. I'm beautiful. Don't expect me to do anything.
Yeah,
except stand here and look beautiful.
These guys are more—they're more serious, and they take their job pretty seriously.
Okay.
Once they get out in the field, you wouldn't even recognize them.
But
it's
these dogs,
work.
Even with the coat, now there's not nearly as much grooming.
No, and actually, we're not allowed. In our standard, we're not allowed to shave off their whiskers. We're not allowed to shave their neck.
Uh-huh.
The only thing we do is trim their feet to tidy them up, and under the ears for cleanliness.
Right. Well, that would make sense too, to trim the feet for the same reason.
Yes,
you know, because
for cleanliness.
They get these tufts of hair that are like snowshoes.
Because if you don't trim it, they'll look like a cavalier.
Right. Right, they'll that's exactly right. And then in the snow or the bad, weather, they get all
so
matted.
So we trim the hair on the around their feet and between their, under their pads and everything to keep it clean.
Right.
And then we also say that when they go out, and these dogs were out running in the mud today, and this is what they look like afterwards, after they dry.
So then you can just brush it off, just like the Bull Terrier.
Exactly. The hair is, I think it's because the hair is so silky. We call them Teflon dogs.
Oh, hey,
so,
that's great.
You know, they get all muddy. They come in. We let them dry. The dirt falls up, and
they don't have a double coat.
They have a single coat with the feathering.
Wow.
And of course, the males are bigger than the females. Uh-huh. These guys are smaller, and the males have more hair.
Okay.
They'll have a heavier feathering on the chest and the legs and the belly than the females do.
Okay.
And of course, she doesn't have much yet because she's still a baby. Yeah. She's just starting to get hers.
Right. What are the health problems in these guys?
There's some incidences of thyroid, and we screen that in our breeding stock to make sure that that they have normal thyroids before we breed them. There's been some with hip dysplasia, but not a very high incidence, so we do screen for that. And of course, we do check for check their eyes to make sure they don't have hereditary cataracts.
Okay.
So those are, and then there was also there's some hereditary disease called CLAD. Which we pretty much has been eliminated because of genetic testing.
Okay. Well, what about epilepsy, which is common in the Irish setter?
Yeah. I don't really know about any incidences of that in the breed.
Okay. And, well, since they're two totally separate breeds,
you wouldn't be
breeding for the same. Well, first of all, definitely not the same stock, but you're breeding for totally different things. But so why did you select this breed?
I had a friend who had one, and every time I went to her house, she was in my lap like this. She'd right in my lap and sit there, and then the opportunity, we would decide we were going to look for a bird dog, and the opportunity came up to get a puppy that was related to my friend's dog, and that was our first one. That was 5 years ago, and now we have six of them.
Oh, my God.
And we show them.
Uh-huh.
Pollyanna's a show dog also. She shows. She's started showing this year only as an adult, and she's already won her first two majors at shows.
Very good.
Plus she's been out hunting, and the puppy has just started showing, so she'll be doing that too.
Mm-hmm.
Her father was actually best of breed for our breed at Westminster this year.
Oh, very good.
So,
very good.
Yeah, so we're hoping that someday she'll show there.
Uh-huh. Wonderful. Very
after
good.
She gets a little calmer.
Yeah. And Scott, why did you select the Bull Terrier?
Bull Terriers really don't get selected. A lot of times they select you.
They would not select me. I am not a Bull Terrier person.
I was handicapped as a child, and my father brought home a Bull Terrier beagle mix that tried to dig to China, was not successful, but the personality and the just the entire look of the breed swayed me very young and been involved in the breed. off and on ever since.
How about that? So. Interesting. I always like to know why people select the breeds they have, and it's always for an unusual reason. When you're talking about the approximate cost of these guys, what would you say as far as, you know, if I wanted to buy a puppy?
Well,
with
breeders, a good breeder sells a dog on a contract.
Mm-hmm.
Okay,
yep.
Yeah, which is extremely important.
Yep, my audience knows that.
They give guarantees on the dogs.
My audience knows that as well.
Especially on the health.
Uh-huh.
And health testing doesn't come cheap.
Right.
But a lot of times when that happens, you end up with a dog that lives longer than a dog that isn't health tested and has problems.
That's exactly
Breed as a whole, from responsible breeders, I would say the average is between about $1,500 and $2,500 across the board, you know,
depending
in the United
on the
States.
Quality, right?
Depending
right.
on the quality and the breeder.
Right. And?
Probably you're going to see between $1,200 and $1,800 right now.
Okay.
And I think that may, you know, as they become more popular more people, that you may see that change.
Right.
Yeah, so.
Yep. You know, people say, oh, well, you know, I'm going to go to the farm and buy one for $300 or $500. And it's like they haven't been health tested at all. So now your $500 dog, because it has hip dysplasia in both hips, you now have maybe $3,000, $5,000 worth of hip repair. So that's a really, really expensive. You now have a $5,500 dog. If it has heart problems, it's now on medication or may need surgery. So you see your expenses adding up and up and up. So your basically cheap dog is costing you three times as much as buying a puppy from a reputable breeder whose stock has been health tested, and you have a dog that's good for the entire life. And these guys may go, you know, 13, 14, 15 years. That's a long time to have a healthy dog. So I guess that's our program for this evening, and I thank both of our guests, Scott Ibbotson and from the Bull Terrier Club of Philadelphia, and Wendy Buckman, and no, she's not related to the pretzel people. It's spelled differently. That's what she told me. So for our program this evening, good night.
On BCTV is supported by the Berks County Kennel Club and by the Berks County Dog Training Club.